what we have had here in many ways this morning is a hurricane blow in across the Mississippi River.
July 22, 2003, a day filled with images we will never forget.
I never heard a thunderstorm sound like a train, woo, like that. And it hit, wham, and I didn't know what happened.
We were just screaming and it was raining on us and we were just hysterical. And it was just this heavy weight.
Never heard a siren. I was never warned that there was going to be a bad storm. And the next thing I know, boy, look at this damage we have here at this house. It's just total devastation.
Nobody went to bed last night expecting something like this. Devastating.
I just laid in there when the storm was so terrible. I just laid in there and prayed.
I just don't know what I'm going to do.
Many thought it was a tornado, but instead, 100-mile-an-hour straight-line winds left more than a twister's small path of destruction.
Just got off the phone with the National Weather Service. They are saying that right now it looks like straight-line winds at this point.
Tonight, in a special one-hour report, a look at that day, what's happened since, and hopefully the lessons we've all learned.
Hurricane Elvis, a year of recovery.
I'm just torn to pieces.
Power lines down, poles smashed to bits or ripped out of the ground. 340,000 people without electricity in the sweltering July heat, left searching for ways to keep cool. Wet towels, hand-powered fans, cool drinks, shade.
Traffic lights hanging by a thread are tossed to the ground.
Trees ripped in half, torn up by the roots, smashed into houses, in front of houses, on top of cars, and carpeting the streets.
Windows gone, cranes about to topple.
We were left wondering, how in the world are we going to get it all cleaned up?
The first day, we just stood and looked. Didn't even know where to start.
Without any electricity, businesses had to shut their doors, losing millions of dollars. People were waiting in line for hours for ice and gas.
I thought it was really odd because that gas station's out of gas, it's out of gas. It's like 10-mile radius. Never seen it before in my life.
Most wishing for the things we take for granted in everyday life.
No coffee. No coffee. That is the worst thing in the world.
Some gritted their teeth and handled it with grace.
No point in getting all worked up about it.
Be patient. That's all I can do. That's all I can do.
With others, tempers were lost.
You don't work for MLGW. I don't pay you.
You don't pay me at all.
I'm trying to get these people fired back on. They act like we're the enemy.
Frustrations with MLGW aired.
I don't think they're doing a good job because we've been out this long. You know, and they coming along, but they ain't doing too good because we still out and it's no air, no nothing.
One minute it's 3 to 4 days, or 2 to 3 days, and the next day it's seven to eight days, so who knows?
I'm very upset and angry.
But in the midst of it all, a glimmer of hope, the Mid-South came together in the face of disaster.
There's nothing like tragedy to get people to cooperate.
There's also good about it, and that's community coming together. I mean, people bring meatloaves over to each other and stuff.
We've had people stop, strangers, offer to help.
At least 5 people would die in the aftermath of the storm, reminding us all of how precious life really is.
It's just the good Lord's will and it must be done, so I'm not complaining. I'm thankful that I'm still alive.
We're very fortunate to be safe.
How dare anybody, anybody in this world, how dare you to sit back and complain about this when people actually lost their lives?
To homes and businesses alone, there was a whopping $410 million in damage. MLGW had $26 million in damage. The storm cost the city of Memphis $15 million. Most of that money was spent getting rid of all of the debris. Memphis City Schools had $12 million in damage, and 2 other towns with big losses, Bartlett and Germantown, with about $600,000 each.
Nearly all of Memphis is cleaned up now, but here are just some signs of what happened to our city 1 year ago.
Well, I was just getting ready for work, and all of a sudden the storm came up and grabbed kids and went downstairs.
We were sleeping, and we heard a loud noise, and the next thing we knew,
We heard a loud crash and everything fell on top of us.
We heard a thunderstorm was going to be here, but we had no idea it would be this bad.
The devastation here is all over the city. I've never seen anything like it.
That this began as a typical southern storm, mm-hmm. and in many ways it did. Of course, it mm-hmm. blossomed into what we now know to be a severe, almost super cell thunderstorm.
I could believe that because I live in downtown Memphis and you could not see. It was so scary. It was anything out of the normal. The trees were actually, those tall trees downtown, bent to the ground. And that's when you get up and you say, let me put on some clothes because we're going to be running for our lives in a minute.
Well, straight line winds can exceed 110, maybe up to 120 miles an hour.
It just literally came out of nowhere. We saw the sky start to darken. There was no real warning that this was coming.
Why no warning? Why no sirens?
Well, we don't normally sound the sirens except for tornadoes, earthquakes, or a terrorist event in Shelby County. We don't sound them for thunderstorms.
Look at the windows there. There you see the blinds hanging out of that building. So this shows you the magnitude of the storm that came through.
Also behind me, there are power lines. The top of the power line has just been snapped off of the wooden pole.
This is one in particular we saw. That's a kitchen at that house. And that tree has just sliced that kitchen right in half.
This is the bottom, the base, the root of a tree that was knocked over. You can see it's several feet taller than me.
There's the house just demolished.
Yeah, it's just the whole front section of the house is just completely just gone.
I spoke to a firefighter, and he said that if this would have happened an hour later, that you would be seeing a casualties all over the place.
Saw a garbage can come flying by our window. Now, Cameron D., we're on the second floor.
Well, it came downtown and hit us real quick. These were straight-line winds. They were swirling, so it scared us to death, and we were on the air. We just had to bolt because the tower's right there, and those cranes behind us are bent at an angle, so the building was evacuated.
The shutters are gone, shingles all over the yard. Everything's in a clutter, and the whole place, it's just torn apart.
I just can't look at it because I just realized how lucky we were to get out of here. There was just so much stuff on top of us, and we were trapped.
We're just getting the first report this morning of someone who has been killed.
He died in his sleep, so he didn't have to worry about no pain or nothing.
Devastating. I mean, that was the guy on Holman that always walked down the street waving to everybody.
We don't have any air, but we can live without that.
I feel blessed. You know, I lost a lot of food, but that could be replaced.
Right now, we have no cold product for sale. Everything is just dry groceries.
We, you know, stopped here and all the gas is gone. We didn't know what to do. We're dead on empty, so we just had to wait it out.
A gentleman in the neighborhood went and got us some ice. You know, ice is kind of hard to find.
When tragedies happen, we have to work together.
This is something you will be hearing about for many, many days. Right. This is not going to end here.
Good Lord's will, and it must be done, so I'm not complaining. I'm thankful that I'm still alive.
This is a vacant lot, but it used to hold John and Lanny Price's home. If you look over here, you could see a faded reminder of what happened at this home nearly a year ago.
Well, he was kind of protective of me. He always tried to protect me.
But on the July morning that caught all of us by surprise, Lanny Price couldn't protect her husband of 30 years from the wrath of Mother Nature.
The 22nd of July last year, I lost everything right over there and out. And the most thing I lost that you can't get back was John, because the other stuff you can get is.
Price remembers that day like it was yesterday.
Well, he had got up earlier. He got up early. I always got to make his coffee. It's raining, really raining out there. I said, yes. He said, yes. So I got up. and went in the kitchen. Then I come back and looked out the door. I said, I might as well go lay back down too.
In an instant, the wind caused a huge tree to slice through their home. It fell on John as he laid in bed.
He was in the bed. Well, I was thinking to go get in the bed, but the law just didn't want me, so he stopped me before I got there because I sure was thinking to go lay down.
Price says her husband's death could have been prevented. She knew her neighbor's trees were a threat.
Them trees didn't have no roots because they just rotted. They just shells sitting on there. All the roots gone. They should have been cut out.
She says her neighbor wanted to have them cut down, but it was too expensive. Who knew that John Price would pay the ultimate price?
Yeah, you think you ain't got strength, but the law will give you strength if you ask it. And that's the only way you can survive.
Price now rents a home across the street, a constant reminder of the day that changed her family's life forever.
Sometimes I look over and look like all the team sitting out in their yard.
Mrs. Price said she'd like to rebuild a home here. It's a place where she has a lot of good memories. But there's one thing that's stopping her from doing that, this tree. She's afraid the same thing could happen again.
Three people died because of fires caused by candles, including a two-month-old baby girl. And several people died because of their generators. 73-year-old Van Branch was killed and his wife critically hurt after carbon monoxide filled their home. There was a generator in the garage.
I mean, it just crushed me because I had just been talking to him the day previous and we was laughing and joking. It just done me in.
At another house, a man arrived home from work to find 10 members of his family passed out.
He came out, yelled for help, and a couple of other neighbors went in and helped him pull all his family members out.
There was also a generator in that family's garage. A 17-month-old boy died from the carbon monoxide. And a 4-year-old drowned in a backyard pool. His mother was inside the house asleep, and police say carbon monoxide was again to blame. There was a generator running in the garage that caused her to pass out while her child wandered outside.
Yes, it's been a very difficult week. It's been a very hard week for everybody. It's just unfortunate.
We heard the storm. We lost power right about 7 a.m.
And when I got to Memphis, the storm had hit real bad, and trees and everything were just everywhere, you know.
The whole way, noticed all the limbs down, trees, power lines, everything was down.
We had got up and we seen trees all over the ground and stuff.
Our building there was on a backup generator, no air conditioning. The pumping stations were all out, so we didn't have enough water pressure to even flush the toilets out there. So they sent us home.
And so we walked around the neighborhood and see if they're about okay. And some people didn't make it.
One year after the superstorm of 2003, people are still rebuilding, as you see here behind me. When the winds blew through, they left a path of destruction behind. But it was also a learning experience for first responders, as well as agencies like MLG&W.
Memphis Light, Gas, and Water have a terrible job to do.
It's a minor inconvenience to be without power, especially with what a lot of people have gone through, the loss of life here locally from deaths from the storm and generators. And we appreciate the efforts of the power company to get things back up and running.
I don't think they're doing a good job because we've been out this long. You know, and they coming along, but they ain't doing too good because we still out and it's no air, no nothing.
Eventually, MLG&W crews did get to everyone.
In last year's storm, we assessed the situation and fixed it as we went along.
But for some, repairs came later rather than sooner.
Altogether, it took at least 13 days.
At night, you got sweat rolling off of you like balls. I mean, you wake up, you bring in with your pillow wet. I mean, come on now, let's be for real.
We haven't seen a truck all day. But that map says they're working in this area. I don't think they told us the truth.
Our observations would be the better assessment you do, the quicker you cut that 13 days down. And it took 13 days to get those 339 customers back home.
While the storm caused deep frustration for everyone, it was also a measuring rod for the way the utility company responds to future disasters.
We did a good job. There again, we had a plan, we followed our plan, we executed our plan.
Even a good plan can use improvement. And one thing this superstorm taught the entire community is that information is key.
And what we would hope to do this, if the same thing happened tomorrow of that level, is to be able to answer that question of when. I believe customers, you know, the when might be 3 days, the when might be 5 days, but I think if they know that when, they're more comfortable in knowing what they've got to do.
MLG&W has done a lot of work on its emergency plan. One of the things they focused on is how they assess the problem. They've also done a lot of work in terms of trying to get more crews here quicker to begin the restoration process.
Today, these plants stand tall on either side of this Ida Wild Elementary sign, but they're actually covering up the remainders of 50-foot tall trees destroyed in last year's superstorm, reminders of the destruction the severe weather caused throughout Memphis City schools.
There were obvious signs of the wind's path all around Ida Wild, the speed limit signpost, the floors, and the school sign.
We've gotten our sign. Our PTO has started a beautification project where they've planted flowers, so we're just thriving and surviving.
Fortunately, no one was hurt.
We were thankful that the children and the people who worked in the summer enrichment program were safe.
Looking at the school today, you can't tell it weathered a massive storm. The gym ceiling has been replaced, the cafeteria walls have been repainted, and the floor has been retiled.
It was a big day when the cafeteria opened because we had warm, hot meals again.
Not far from Ida Wild, a new driver's education building is going up to replace the one knocked down by the storm. This was the school district's most badly damaged area.
We've had to try to find places to hold the classes that we were holding at the driver ed building itself.
The driving simulator trailers were picked up and flipped over by the wind. They've been replaced, and except for a few minor dents, 39 cars have been restored.
The most difficult thing was trying to get those cars fixed as quickly as we could.
All that's left is getting this new building completed.
The exterior walls are up, the foundation's in place, and hopefully by November, construction will be over and students can move into this new driver's ed facility. In Midtown, I'm Michaeline Tete for Eyewitness News.
Now, across the street from Ike's, over here, Union Avenue Baptist Church, which I believe you're seeing now, damage over there. Windows have been blown out there, including some of the beautiful stained glass windows.
Union Avenue was one of just many houses of worship in the area hit by the storm. Shingles were ripped away. Windows were blown out. The sanctuary had a giant hole up top, giving people a clearer view of heaven.
Our sanctuary roof was lifted off the sanctuary. We have about a 50 by 125 foot hole in the sanctuary roof, so obviously we could not meet in there this morning because of structural damage and concerns of safety.
At the Church of the Good Shepherd Episcopal, the holy ground was scattered with trees.
And then I couldn't get in the church. I had to park in the grass. There were trees everywhere.
They were stunned and at first could only stare at the damage.
The first 2 days was, the first day we just stood and looked. Didn't even know where to start.
It's just a total disaster inside.
Most of our damage is tree damage. There are holes in the roof.
It's going to have a new roof on it. I guess it's going to run close to $30,000, $35,000 worth of damage.
But the storm couldn't stop the church members from celebrating on Sunday, no matter where they had to meet.
Come thou fount of every blessing.
Union Baptist proved the church isn't the building, it's the people. Even the piano was rolled out into this tent temple of worship.
The reason we did that is because we wanted to show to the community and to our church that we were still here and that we were not going anywhere and this wasn't going to deter us from doing the Lord's work.
You're thinking about how strange this whole event is.
Across town at Christ the King, the building was still intact, but the heat was on.
We had all of our elders call folks and tell them to not dress up and not wear coats and ties and come strip down as far as they can strip down and still be respectable in church.
As the pastor put it, this service was without electric power, but it was filled with the power of God. And no matter where they worshiped that day, everyone was just thankful to be alive.
And the good Lord is pretty good to us. He didn't hurt anybody, and that's the main thing.
Well, I was watching the news, and they said we were going to have a storm.
And it was terrific. It was just, the winds were so strong. All of a sudden, I'm like Jane, all of a sudden they came up.
And it really was scary.
I had been in a tornado before, years ago in Jackson, Mississippi. So I was really nervous.
It went, heavens. So I turned and went back in the house and got in there just in time. I mean, it was awful.
And I have a pantry. I thought, well, if it gets worse, I'm going in there. There's a lot of food in there. I could camp.
I had to call the fire department and the light, gas, and water. My brother's on oxygen. And they had to bring a generator out, and he was without oxygen or for a couple of days, other than the portables that we have.
As you can see, in the area we have, you know, extensive damage, you know, quite a bit of damage. But we were fortunate that the storm hit when it did. If it had occurred about an hour later, there would have been the potential for a lot more injuries.
Susan Crawford is resting comfortably right now, but her ankle could use a little help.
And we were just walking out for our little morning walk, and it just came up so fast. That's all I remember is just really fast. And we were trying to start running home, and we couldn't make it.
Enter Dr. Lloyd Finks, who happened to be there to lend a hand to Susan and her friend.
Both of them are comfortable, and as far as their vital signs go, they're both stable. I think they're both going to be really sore for a while, and one of the ladies may have injuries that are more serious than the other.
In fact, Dr. Finks tried to use his own Range Rover to get the two people in his care to the safety of a hospital. But seeing the lay of the land around him and the trees laying around him, he figured the best thing to do was to give these women the comforts of his home.
People have come by checking on us, making sure that, you know, we have water and everything that we need. And now we just had one of the orthopedic residents from Campbell's come by just to help out and walked his way over here from several, you know, streets away. So it's a really great experience, and it kind of renews your faith in God and the people around you.
And if it hadn't been for them, I guess we'd still be lying there in the middle of the street.
At that time, all Susan could do was sit and wait for whatever help could arrive. But she is thankful that the neighborhood doctor was feeling neighborly on this day.
Dr. Finks is the kindest doctor I've ever had in my whole life. He's so kind.
Did you know him before all of this?
Never.
Ominous skies, a breeze in the air. It's nearly a year later, but this day nothing like the superstorm of 2003.
It was probably one of the top windstorms of my career. At its peak, AutoZone Park had 102 mile an hour winds.
Despite having 18 minutes of warning from the National Weather Service, the July superstorm was a surprise. Scott Corretto of the National Weather Service believes a change in Mid-Southerners' mindset will prepare us for next time.
Well, some of the societal lessons that we learned is take a severe thunderstorm warning as the same way you would as a tornado warning. Put as many walls between you and those thunderstorm or tornado winds. Another thing that we did learn is be prepared, have a plan, and make sure you have and practice your plan as well.
Corretto also believes the Clear Channel family of television and radio stations will also play a major role to keep Mid-Southerners safe in future events.
The best thing to do is listen to your commercial broadcasters, because they do get the warning from the National Weather Service when you're in your car, and often more than not, they broadcast that information to the general public when they do obtain a warning from the National Weather Service.
It may be tomorrow, it may be 100 years from now. Who knows the next time that we'll see a storm as strong as the one that struck the Mid-South area on July 22, 2003. But one thing is for sure, having a plan will likely save your life.
Actually, my wife got up first and said, "You gotta come see this." And I said, "Well, it's just a storm." She goes, "No, not like this."
I was in the house sleep. I woke up, looked outside, thought the world coming to an end.
It all of a sudden got really dark and really loud and just absolutely horrendous.
I woke up and looked outside, seen garbage cans blowing down the street. And I closed the door and got under my mattress.
We all got in the pit area where we were doing the work at.
It was pretty scary. And we had several big trees in our neighborhood that really looked like they could topple any second, and the sky was yellow. It was pretty frightening.
Pretty amazing and horrible damage, and almost like a tornado hit.
Several weeks ago, we invited Memphis Mayor Willie Harrington to be part of our special report on Hurricane Elvis, since certainly it is one of the most catastrophic events to strike during his time in office. And there are some obvious questions, like, Mr. Mayor, what lessons did the city learn? How can the city improve its response and help people recover faster next time? Those are questions most leaders would expect and indeed welcome, but as you can see, Mayor Harrington isn't here. He refused to be interviewed for this special. Maybe that has something to do with the other questions, like, Mr. Mayor, you've been criticized by many people for not being very visible in the aftermath of the storm, not providing a reassuring leadership presence. Where were you? Why did you think it was so important to leave town and go to Little Rock for a campaign fundraising event for your reelection when your city was in crisis?
And I really did trust my insurance company. I believed they were my friends.
The day the big storm blew in, Gwen Simmons' life changed forever.
And the water was in the house. Sheetrock, insulation, every ceiling in this house was soaked.
Simmons lives around boxes, supplies. The place is a mess. For the last year, she's been fighting the insurance company about the cost and scope of repairs.
I had six contractors walk in. They looked through the house. They looked at the insurance specs from my insurance company, and they kept walking.
Simmons isn't alone when it comes to insurance problems. Many Mid-Southerners learned what insurance did and didn't cover. For example, insurance usually covers a fallen tree if it falls on your home.
But say a big tree like this falls in your yard and doesn't hit anything, doesn't do any damage, well, guess what? You'll be responsible for paying for the cleanup.
When it comes to replacing your home and belongings, people learned about replacement coverage.
Here's what that means. Take my 10-year-old computer. Say it's destroyed. With replacement insurance, I should get enough money from my insurance agency to go out and buy a new computer. If I don't have it, the insurance company will probably depreciate my computer, which means this 10-year-old computer, well, it won't be worth very much.
Don Batchelor says the lesson learned, know what your policy says and know what you're getting.
People think insurance is insurance. So I can go, you know, this one's $1,200, this one's $1,400. Well, I'll buy the $1,200 one. And what they don't look at is all of these other coverages.
To them, it may be a business. But to me, this is my home. This was my life.
Gwen Simmons thought she had good coverage too. But 1 year after the storm, she's giving up.
It's hard, but I'm going to do it. I don't really have a choice.
Walking away from her home of 11 years.
So I have my tree and my Easter lilies. And I'm going to lose my house. And I'm going to lose my...
We might pick up your limbs today. We might pick up your limbs in 8 weeks. But it's our hope that within 8 weeks, we will have the job completed.
Quite a few of us had tree damage from the straight line winds. We're still cleaning up. But hopefully we've learned to be a little more proactive as homeowners so this doesn't happen again.
It was a huge mess. Trees toppled everywhere, some on top of our homes. Nobody wants to go through this again.
And I'm still nervous about having the trees around my house, to be honest with you, because now I'm wondering if it's something we need to worry about with the kids upstairs.
That's why the tree guys are keeping busy.
And a good lean, but you don't want to take it out.
No, it doesn't have to come out.
Wesley Jones, a.k.a. the tree doctor, doesn't like chopping down trees. Even though these look a little too close for comfort, they're being saved.
Have it checked out for broken limbs that you can't see from the ground. It may be split. Have them cut out the dead wood.
That has to be done by an expert, but there are signs of trouble you can see for yourself. See that dead branch just hanging there? That's got to go. And if the roots start popping out of the ground, you've got trouble.
And we noticed the big smashed window.
Kelly Dodato called the tree doctor because a dead limb just did this.
Just because a tree is leaning or close to your home doesn't mean it has to be taken down. Sometimes it just needs to be trimmed up, or what's called cabling.
Then we have a back tree back here. We can run a cable from that tree over this tree just for the extra security of it.
That cabling will make the tree twice as strong in a windstorm. Also, cutting out dead and split limbs and those that are hanging over the house is a must.
There's a good chance you can keep the trees on your property, but it's a good idea to let the tree experts offer up their opinion. In Midtown, Tom Butler, Eyewitness News.
Get together an emergency kit. Not many of us had these ready to go. Here's what it should include: flashlight and batteries, a battery-operated radio. Those came in really handy last year, and most of us had to go out and buy one at the last second. Have a first aid kit and manual, any medication you need for about a week, and of course, plenty of emergency food and water, and a non-electric can opener to help out.
Our power didn't get cut back on until about like 2 weeks later.
Considering all the people that were without utilities, I think they did.
They did a good job. They did a good job.
I guess they did an okay job. I mean, I can't go either way. I wish we had power earlier, but 10 days could have been worse. Could have been more like 20 or even 30 for some people.
From what they had, they did a good job. Just the sheer amount of damage, I think, was the biggest problem. We simply weren't prepared, I think, for the amount.
Oh, they did a good job.
They were slow at getting the work done, and I believe that they needed outside help to really come in and work on the utility.
Truthfully, I think they did above and beyond the call of duty. I don't think they could have done any more than what they did.
From everything I know, people are working real hard and people are working together down here, and I just want to say the state's going to do its part, and we're going to get this together and hope to get the president to sign it in the next 2, 3, 4 days and get some financial help down here.
One year later, there are still traces of Hurricane Elvis. This car has been here since the storm hit. Emergency leaders say they didn't realize the extent of the damage until they first saw it on television. Fear.
No, I can't leave, and they can't get to me.
frustration.
Tired. I want my power on pretty soon.
Fright.
Oh, we can pray for everybody else in this town. Hope everybody can come out on this thing all right.
Scenes like this sent Mid-Southerners on an emotional roller coaster. The storm crept up with little warning.
It came up so suddenly. We didn't have a lot of warning that it was coming across.
As quickly as it arrived, it was gone, but the storm left its mark.
But once we started seeing on TV, we knew that we were in for a long stand, and we had a whole lot of work that we were going to have to do.
Morning, Emergency Operations Center.
The county's emergency management office sprung into action, deploying workers to man phones and coordinating all emergency assistance.
There were people that had, that were on life support systems, and we got generators to their homes and kept their oxygen machines running.
Leaders say they were proud of their response despite a storm of anger over tornado sirens.
Some of the people called in, why didn't you set off the sirens? Well, the storm was over by the time that we should have set the sirens off.
Hurricane Elvis also served as a learning experience. Emergency managers had to make changes, starting with shortening their own hours.
As we were all working 20-hour shifts.
They also had to reconfirm the EOC office as central command and the only place to get information.
And hopefully when the next one occurs, we'll be able to have one voice and put out good information from one source, not two or three.
Emergency leaders also realized a need to staff more volunteers and manage them better.
And we had volunteers. We didn't have enough just to man the phones.
In the end, even through the massive damage, was a clearer view of how to handle it.
We're human. We're gonna make mistakes, but we're not gonna make the same mistakes again.
Emergency leaders say they've also rewritten how several agencies respond to disasters. They want to be better prepared, not if another storm hits, but when it hits. In Midtown Memphis, Bonnie Kinney, Eyewitness News.
I think to be prepared.
Yeah, I always keep some water on hand and keep a generator and some gas.
Well, we bought a generator, so that was one thing.
You have to be prepared because you never know when a flood is going to happen, snowstorm and everything, because Memphis is really not prepared for this type of adventure.
To keep things better supplied, I used to have water on hand and I had let it deplete.
Flashlights help, working flashlights. We went through a lot of candles.
I was on the air the day the storm hit. Everybody had to evacuate. One police officer stayed at the front door upstairs, top of the landing, and said, Craig, I'm going to yell to you if those cranes start moving. You better start moving and getting out of here. On the morning of July 22nd, 2003, I walked out this door. Our broadcast ended here on Beale Street as everything picked up at ABC 24, where we set up shop for the next 8 days. In fact, as I walked out that door with the Memphis Police Department, this window completely blown out. The wind still howling around and swirling around on Beale Street. Now, Eyewitness News reporter Kevin Jenks has more.
Craig was right there in that building the morning of the storm, and over here, the 500-foot cranes were. Three of them hit by 100-mile-per-hour winds, threatening to fall at any moment.
He heard the radio, you know, the radio broadcast about the radio broadcast on the site between the people on the site about the approaching storm, and he immediately got out of the cab and got safely to the ground.
The first thing I noticed was the cranes that were leaning just precariously in the wrong direction, kind of scary looking.
Police are evacuating the area.
And that's the reason why, right there.
Mm-hmm.
That crane is leaning at least 10 degrees off center.
On the crane nearest to Beale Street, eight of these huge bolts, about the length of your arm, either came out of the base or were broken in half. The FedEx Forum was actually holding the crane up. It was resting against the building shell. Several blocks in downtown were quickly evacuated, including Beale Street.
The one on the right side of your screen, if it goes the way that the counterbalance or the counterweight is going now, it will hit Beale Street and it will have about a 500-foot radius of damage.
Right now, Beale Street remains in a hazardous area.
The cranes were a lost cause.
None of these cranes are in a condition to use any further on the project.
But it would take more than a week to get the crane stable enough to open Beale Street again. Businesses along this historic strip say that cost them about $1 million. But as you can see behind me, the FedEx Forum was able to quickly recover. Construction should be finished at the end of next week. Kevin Jinks, Eyewitness News.
The effects of the July 22nd storm took their toll on everybody down here. Not just people, but buildings as well. An entire facade and lots of glass were missing from the Gibson Guitar Factory, much of it blown into nearby areas. Eyewitness News reporter Tran Bowie shows us what people in this area experienced.
And we see the video of what the wind did as well, the debris from the Gibson Guitar Factory there. This is done by wind, folks. I mean, this is fierce wind.
Been on Beale Street 10 years. And then for something like this to come through in like a second, it seemed like, and then just to tear out a half a building.
And there you see the Gibson Guitar Factory, and anyone who has ever been there knows how magnificent this building is, and to see it destroyed in such a manner with the beautiful windows out there, you see the gaping hole pretty much.
I think the most eerie thing was coming out of the building, going to my car, and seeing part of the bricks from the Gibson Guitar Factory inside my car that came crashing through the windows. I still have a couple of those bricks as souvenirs, I guess you could say.
Incredible. I mean, it's kind of sad in a way that a beautiful building like that was destroyed, but the good thing is hopefully nobody was hurt.
We're diehard music people in this city. It ain't gonna take us long to build that back. And we're all gonna pitch in if we have to. We will.
1 year later, the Gibson building is back. Now, would you believe that's where the gaping hole was? The damage is gone, but the memories will never go away. In downtown Memphis, Tran Bowie, Eyewitness News.
While crews worked inside the yellow tape to clear the trolley line and downtown businesses on Linden and Wagner, across the street, two families were picking up what was left of their homes.
I could hear the roof coming off the top, and the rains, the sky was pitch black, but there was no warning at all, none.
Now with no roof above their heads, water is still moving in. Judy Jucker and her husband have weathered the storms in their downtown loft for 10 years, but they say they've never been hit with something this fierce.
No, there's no words to describe it. It really humbles you.
And for Greg Janes, what was supposed to be a new beginning next door in Memphis ended just 10 days after he moved into his loft. Janes was left sorting the rubble this morning on his 55th birthday.
He just moved here from New York. He's from here. It's his 55th birthday today, and he's lived here about a month. So we're helping him cope.
It's just crazy looking. It's like surreal.
But even after such a blow, the Juckers have kept things in perspective.
We're thankful to be alive, so we'll just move on from here. We got a lot of good friends taking care of us, so we'll get through it.
In downtown Memphis, Jessica Taff, Eyewitness News.
Neighbors pitch in with one another, too. That's a good thing.
They're all supportive.
We survived last year's storm, and so it was a blessing we survived.
You know, I guess one of the great things that came out of it is we really got to know our neighbors really well.
I feel very fortunate when I consider or think about all the other people that had to do with that.
It was kind of nice seeing the community pull together. So that was the biggest thing, is we relied on our neighbors a lot.
I haven't seen a city rally as well.
Mess, you know, and I just really regret not filling up, you know, the night before, you know, the storm hit, but, you know, who knew that this was going to happen.
Pretty unbelievable, isn't it?
He calls the situation, in his unofficial opinion, a total loss. If you look behind me, the store has sustained damage. They are trying to put the plywood over the front windows. All of the front windows, except probably one, maybe two, were blown out when the storm hit this morning.
Well, that's what Ike's looked like then, and this is what it looks like now, a year later. It's a brand new Ike's, almost finally ready to open. But this wasn't the only business hit hard by the storm.
When I first saw it happen, I just took and left the ranch and I went to the back. And I never saw anything else.
A lot of things were just shut down.
If you're concerned about prescriptions or getting to the stores, we do have a report about Walgreens. About two-thirds of all the Walgreens in the area, they're closed right now.
Some businesses were badly damaged. Others had no electricity. They all had no option but to close the doors. Many people were just out of luck.
I was completely out of gas. I was calling my mom to bring me some from Collierville.
I finally found a McDonald's way down on Getwell that was open. It had a line out onto the street, and I waited in that line for 48 minutes, and they were out of coffee when I got up there. It broke my heart.
We, you know, stopped here, and all the gas is gone. We didn't know what to do. We're dead on empty, so we just had to wait it out.
Some places rolled with the punches, setting up generators just to make sure people had what they needed.
We got no lighting, got nothing. We tried to do the best, you know, for the neighborhood, because, you know, like a lot of stores closed and everything. So we tried, you know, to do something. But like last night, we stayed open until 11:30. And the night, all the store, all is dark and everything, and all the stores closed. But we stayed till 11:30.
A lot of food and a lot of money had to be thrown into the trash.
If it is safe, it will go for sale. If it is not, then it will be destroyed.
Some business owners got a little inventive, doing business like it had never been done before.
Bills still have to be paid, seriously, and we're going to do what we need to do.
No electricity at all, but a man's got to make a living. You got to make some money somehow.
And despite the heat and the losses, everyone took it in stride.
That's what it takes when you dedicate yourself to being a businessman. You got to roll with the punches.
Chris Zellman, Eyewitness News.
And every time it starts getting really windy or really dark outside at times of the day when it's not supposed to, I get a little nervous.
It's certainly a learning experience, I can assure you of that.
It taught me to prepare better for a storm.
Always be prepared, and if they say, you know, hey, get down, and you don't always have that much time to react.
I learned not to look out a window when a storm comes.
I respect a storm more so now than before.